The BSON Lecture Series is a new series of monthly webinars which aim at the full integration of Palestine into the global learning community.
We sponsor discourses on subjects of cultural, scientific, and societal importance by leading research experts and public intellectuals of varied heritage and viewpoints.
These interactive webinars are free and open to the public, and recordings of each will be posted soon after the end of each lecture.
The SAN Center for Research and Development is a non-partisan civil society organization that was founded back in 1989. We work on connecting young scholars with the global community of research to contribute to the creation and establishment of these connections and this community of learning, where sciences of all forms can be used and utilized for the benefit of man.
The BSON Lecture Series is the response of the international academic community to the Israeli attacks against the inalienable right of the Palestinian people to education and academic freedom. We stand in solidarity with the six Palestinian NGOs targeted by the Israeli government, and through them, with the entirety of Palestinian civil society.
I'm Ivar Ekeland. I am the president of the French ORDIP, Academic Association in Defense of International Law in Palestine, and I'll be chairing this session, the first of the business lectures. The first thing to say is that there will be a simultaneous translation in Arabic. Ahmed, you may say so.
شكرا إيفار المتابعون على الزوم والذين يفضلون الاستماع إلى المحاضرة بالترجمة الفورية إلى اللغة العربية يرجى النظر على أيقونة الترجمة في أسفل الشاشة التي تمثلها الكرة الأرضية واختيار العربية هذا الخيار غير متاح لمستمعي الفيسبوك شكرا جزيلا لنمير قسيس الذي يقدم الترجمة الفورية
So, this session is a presentation by Daniel Pauly. It's a great privilege to introduce Daniel Pauly, who's been time and time again registered as one of the 50 most influential scientists in the world. Certainly, he has been extremely influential on me. His work is on the sea. I would like to say that the sea is the concentrate of all our problems, except that the sea is not the concentrate at all. It's an enlargement. Our planet is mostly sea, not Earth. And so on the sea, we see all the problems of our civilization. We see slavery at sea. We see tax evasion. We see overexploitation. We see climate change. And Daniel Pauly has been at the forefront to fight all these evils. Today, he's going to talk to us about the Mediterranean, the Southern Mediterranean, which is a most of us have a direct experience of. And he's going to talk about this essential feature of the sea, which is the fisheries, the fish and fisheries. So now, before giving the floor to Daniel, I would like to say that, as usual, he'll talk about 45 minutes, and then there'll be a time for questions. Questions have to be asked on the chat list. They will be collected, and I will ask them on your behalf at the end. But please, any questions on the chat. Thank you very much. And now, Daniel, you have the floor.
Hey. It is my pleasure to be talking to you, and I will present the fisheries of the southern Mediterranean, and you will see what they have in common and how they differ from those maybe of other countries. I share my screen. And there we are. So the fisheries of the southern Mediterranean from Morocco to Turkey. I should mention that I have been teaching courses in Algeria, in Egypt, in Tunisia. I have also been in Turkey. I've visited Israel once. And so I'm familiar. And moreover, I had an excellent student recently from Tunisia who contributed several images that I will show. So the next slide. Why does this one not move? I have a little problem because I cannot make this move.
Is that any chance?
Okay. That you still
you can share it again, maybe.
You see it now?
No, we don't see it. We see just you. So share it again.
Share it again. Now we share it, and why the hell does it not move? I'm really worried. That should move to the next one. Ah, okay. So the Mediterranean.
Can you put it full screen? Can you put it full screen?
Yeah, I can. The Mediterranean is dominated in terms of fisheries by Italy. You can see the various countries here, and the gorilla in the room is Italy. But Italy is in the north of this line, and this line it separates the member state of the European Union, all of them, from those that are not, with the exception of Cyprus. Southern Cyprus, which is in the European Union. So every time you see, you hear scientists from, let's call it the North, talk about the Mediterranean, they really often exclude the Southern Mediterranean as if it didn't exist. So the modeling work, the comparison between countries, the work is that is funded by the European Union, usually does not include scientists from the South, and it is simply assumed that there are no scientists, or that they don't contribute, and there are no data because they don't look. But if you look, you will find stuff being done now. I will show you another example of this bias, which is global. This was in an article published in Science that supposedly analyzed the global fisheries. It made statement about the global fisheries have been being in relatively good shape. And you can see that the data that were used originated from only a few data points for Asia, the whole of Africa, and South America, where the rest of the data that were used originate from the globe on the West and from the Oceania, Australia, and this is this was the case also for the Med, and this is the global view in fisheries. Fisheries literature is very often biased that way, and inferences about the global fisheries originate only from the north, from the global north, and the the Mediterranean is a case in point. Now, if you look at fisheries, you have to look at all its elements, because while industrial fisheries are often have high catches, artisanal fisheries, for example, employ many more people. Subsistence fisheries are in some countries extremely important because they are the only one that produces fish that is actually to be found in cooking pots. In many countries, subsistence fisheries are actually the only fisheries that feed people, in the South Pacific, for example. And recreational fisheries are extremely important because enormous sums are spent by recreational fishers to catch a few fish. And this can be making the difference in the economy of a country. And discarded fish, which is usually, it is never considered in statistics, is also very important. 10% of the world fish are discarded. This applies in general. I should mention that I had an excellent student from Tunisia. She is now back in Tunisia. And some these images and a few other originate from her thesis. And she did her thesis comparing the countries from the southern Mediterranean and the Arabian Peninsula. So how do we know about what fisheries do? Well, it starts obviously with fishers that land fish in ports and markets, and the institution, the management institution, the collect information on them, on the fisheries, and they are handled by by at the ministry level or in fisheries department. Sorry, and they are then sent by the governments to the Food and Agriculture of the United Nations. So if you work in one country, you can work with fishers, you can work in the port and markets, but if you work internationally, as I do, you are forced to work with FAO data because this is the only data set that covers the whole world. Now, every step up is a loss of information because only some fishes are sampled, only some ports are sampled. Local institutions have problems with personnel, and they can analyze only some of the data that they have. And the FAO doesn't keep all the details of the data that are sent to them. For example, the geographic location. So the data lose resolution and uncertainty is added. So we have developed a procedure which we call catch reconstruction, which inverts this process by starting with FAO data and checking if local data are more detailed, and checking with publication and linkages with local experts to reconstruct the catch that was really generated, as opposed to the catch that the country sent to FAO as part of the data. And I had lots of students from the Arab world, if I can say, that have done this for West Africa, the Gulf State, the Arabian Peninsula, and the Southern Mediterranean. And this was embedded in a global project where we have reconstructed the catch of all fisheries of the world. And this procedure of reconstructing the catch starts obviously with the FAO data at the top. And then we attempt to find what sector were omitted. For example, FAO never mentions the recreational fisheries and never covers subsistence fisheries, which are conducted very often by women in many countries. And they do not have a good resolution in terms of taxonomy, what fish are being caught. So we do extensive literature search, and at the end, we end up with a catch that is based on FAO data, based on national data, but includes all the stuff that was omitted. And for example, this dissertation did it, updated the data that we already had for the Mediterranean, for the Southern Mediterranean and the Arabian Peninsula. So the result is, for example, for Morocco. Now Morocco has a chunk of the Mediterranean in the southwest, and there you see the catch that is reported. This is the black line at here. The black line is the catch that Morocco reports to FAO, but from the area that is shown here. The pink area is the inshore area where only artisanal fisheries are supposed to operate, and small-scale fisheries, artisanal, recreational, and sport fisheries. And the rest is the exclusive economic zone of Morocco in the Med. And you can see that Morocco catches much more than it reports to FAO. But I will not say anything bad about Morocco, because they need all the support all the world of the world now, because in 2 hours they're going to meet their fate in a match against France, right? Am I right? Yes. So how are the stock doing in Morocco? And generally, people say in the north of in Europe in that there are no data in the south, and we cannot assess the stocks. And a methodology has been recently developed by our associate. It's called CMSY. MSY is maximum sustainable yield, and C refers to the catch, where we can infer from the catch that you see here on this catch is extracted from the biomass that is in the sea, and two parameters can describe the trajectory of biomass given this catch. That is the population growth rate and the initial population. The population growth rate is R, and the initial population is K, the carrying capacity. And it turns out that with very few constraint, you can identify a space where this combination of parameters is optimal. So you can identify that space, and the Monte Carlo method, where you can estimate thousands of biomass trajectories, and you end up with a biomass trajectory which tells you, which is compatible with a catch and with reasonable estimates of this population growth rate. And this allows you to estimate the biomass. This is a method that can be used even in data poor situation, such as in the Southern Mediterranean. And when this is applied, you can see whether the stocks are overfished or not. And you can see that this stock of fish was in a green zone. It was in good shape. That is, the biomass was sufficient to produce the maximum sustainable yield. But in later it grew into the red zone, which it shouldn't be. This is a dangerous place to be. And we can do these things very, very easily, straightforwardly. This is a method that, for example, my student has applied, that that is being applied by researchers throughout the world. And the problem of not having enough data in the South, in the global South, is largely resolved. The next country that we want to mention is Algeria. You can see the exclusive economic zone, and Algeria has a problem of of overfishing that is due to the fact that Algeria has a big program of subsidization, where young people are given the means to buy boats so that they don't do stupid things and they can go fish. They can go fishing, and the government doesn't care too much whether there's too many boats or not, and too many fishers or not, and the result is overfishing. This is Algeria. You can see an example of overfishing for sparrow. This method it can be applied. You can see the stock size declining and this fish moving straight up into the overfishing situation. Now we are in Tunisia. Somehow Libya got skipped. We are in Tunisia, where essentially the whole pathology of overfishing is there, but it doesn't yet show, because there has been an increase of sardine in the last years, because essentially the big fish along in the Mediterranean are gone, and small fish tend to increase. Also, there has been a shift in the temperature that seems to be benefiting sardinella. So again, we have a stock that has been assessed, and you can see that hake in Tunisia is not doing well. I show you this because until recently, people would have said, "Oh, we cannot assess the fisheries of the southern Med because the data are not there," and you can do it. Interestingly, there is a huge amount of resistance against using such computer intensive but data poor method. There is a huge resistance because some colleagues from the north say they would like, they can see the competition they come up. They don't like really to empower colleagues in the south. I have the impression that they don't. Much of the criticism of this data poor method are due to colleagues in the South becoming independent of them, of their expertise. That is a little bit like when the zero was introduced in the West in 1200 or something, and the people who used Roman numbers and made money making computation for people, all of a sudden they saw their business go away. Anyway, so where are we? Ah, we're in Libya. They were inverted. The problem with Libya, there are several issues with Libya. One of them is that Libyan fisheries were not very developed in the past. And so there are resources in Libya that are not available elsewhere. On the other hand, Libya is now used, the vessels in Libya have been used mainly for people smuggling, and the Libyan fisheries are falling apart. And you can see that in a declining catches, and I leave Libya alone. So that is, where am I? Ah, Egypt. Now, Egypt was very interesting because the catch was influenced by the building of the Lake Nasser. You know that Lake Nasser captures the entire sediment load that created Egypt in the antiquity. And this sediment load is not anymore coming into the Mediterranean. And it is supposed to have caused the decline of sardine and other fish in the 70s. And hence you have this decline. But on the other hand, the pollution that is coming out of the big cities, Alexandria being foremost, is supposed to have replaced that. And so the enrichment of the Med around Egypt is now causing supposedly renewal of sardines and other fish. This is an interesting fact, an interesting thing that pollution is supposed to have there a positive effect. And in Egypt, we have over 100 years of catches, much better than for other countries. But the Egyptian stocks are very much overfished, as you can see here. Indeed, in stock size, is way below the maximum sustainable yield, and Egypt, by fishing so strongly, loses fish and potential for the future. The Gaza Strip. Now, the Gaza Strip. We are probably the first international group to have studied the Gaza Strip in terms of its fisheries. And this is the dynamic since 1950 of the Gaza Strip. And you can see the reported catch is lower than the actual catch so far we can imagine. But how do we know the catches in the first place? Because they were not reported. And we succeeded in convincing our colleague in Israel to separate the catch that they reported from the Gaza Strip as Israeli catch. We managed to convince them to separate their catch. And here are two papers that our group initiated with a colleague from Palestine. We corrected the marine fishery catch for the Gaza Strip, and the Israelis made in the same issue of a journal corrected their catches by removing the catch from the Gaza Strip. So at least we can see what is really caught in Gaza. That the real problem remained, though, that the fisheries of Gaza are squeezed. They are squeezed at lots of levels because the Israeli authority often declare the vessels to be used for nefarious purposes. And the best analysis I've read of this was published recently in the New York Times, and I would be very pleased to send this article to anybody who doesn't have access to it. I have a PDF of it, and I will be pleased to send these papers and this New York Times article, which is quite long, 3-4 pages, and explains in detail what the Israeli blockade of Gaza, of the Gaza Strip in the water, and the means for the fisheries of that territory. Israel is running industrial fisheries. You can see the sardine stock going down, and their catch is declining rapidly because of overfishing. I should mention that we are the only group in the world that, the only group in the world that assess the reliability of the catch statistics that we present from 1 to 4. FAO doesn't do that. And the catch statistics in Israel are quite good, but the management is not better than anywhere else. Lebanon was interesting because in Lebanon, we worked with colleagues in some university that they had in the north of Lebanon. But they had, because of the civil war, during the civil war, the Department of Fisheries burned down and the archives. So they had difficulties in reconstructing what happened in the countries. We were able to do that, and this is the catch. I will speak later about other things than the catch, but this was reconstructed, and having a catch time series make it possible to assess the stocks. So it was very important. It is very important to generate catches. Syria, we were able to reconstruct the catch of Syria, working with some scientists along the coast, and even doing the civil war there. It didn't affect much of the coastal people, and we were able to maintain interaction with Syrian colleagues, and this is the result. I told you some of it would be boring. And in Cyprus, as you know, in the southern part is part of the EU. The northern part is controlled by Turkey. And I had a Turkish Canadian student who was able to talk to both sides, and we were able to reconstruct the fisheries of both sides. And in the north, the fisheries is more or less in existence. Finally, on this line, Turkey. How about it? Now, Turkey has, as you know, this island along the coast that are Greek. So they have Greek island and Turkish coast that are intertwined. And this is a potential conflict, and you're not supposed to publish a map in Turkey or with Turkish colleagues. They go banana if you do that, showing what could be Greek and what could be Turkish territory. If we had Turkish colleagues here, they would complain about this map because it shows what could be Turkey, what could be Greek, and they go banana when you show that. Now, that's the catch by gear. Now, the catch by gear, the catch by fishery type. And I could have shown you that for all countries, the catch by fishery type, by small scale and by gear, sorry. Small scale gear includes if you have an artisanal boat, a small boat owned by the crew or the skipper, owned by the skipper, that is a characteristic of artisanal fisheries. So they make in that region that the Gulf of Sidra, Tunisian plateau, they make about 40% of the catches that are made there. And bottom trawlers make about what, 20%. And you can see bottom trawlers throughout the Mediterranean are the biggest problem because they destroy habitat and they do not select for the fish. The fish that they can catch. They catch everything in their path, and they flatten the soil, the ground, and with the result that the area becomes gradually less productive. Pertains are used mainly to catch pelagic fish, such as sardines or tuna, and they are industrial gear. Longline caught used to catch large pelagic fish. They include thousands, sometimes millions of hooks, of baited hooks. And there is other gear that are used. And that is an example of the gear situation in the southern Mediterranean. And that's the catch of turkey. We're not interested. And in the Gulf of Sidra, that I've shown you before. And in the Levantine area, we have I show you here, the industrial, artisanal, subsistence, and recreation fisheries. And it is very important to know what kind of fishery operates there. You can see, or in other countries, but because we have it for other all countries, the catch by species, the catch by sectors, the catch by gear, we have it for all species, for all countries in the world. And you can see that industrial fishing is very important. And industrial fishing employs very few people and employs a lot of capital, because you have to construct big boats and you deploy them. And essentially, industrial fisheries have political support. Artisanal fisheries employ lots of people. They produce fish that are consumed locally, mostly. The industrial fishery is very often for exports. And artisanal fisheries employ lots of people, but they don't get much support. In most countries, and that is true also for the southern Mediterranean. Subsistence is what people catch for their home consumption, and it is small in the southern Mediterranean. It also includes traditional giving of fish by fishers to families that have no fish. That is a traditional generosity thing, but in other countries, for example, in the Southern Pacific, it can be huge. And recreational fishing is not really a thing much in the Southern Mediterranean, but it can be very important and bring in lots of money because of tourism. And my last point is, that I will spend some time in, is the invasion of the Mediterranean by fish through the Suez Canal into the Red Sea. That is an example of, it's the most horrible fish that you can imagine. Came from the Red Sea. It's called Lagocephalus, the head of the rabbit, rabbit-headed Sceleratus, that means a gangster rabbit head. This fish can get to 1 meter and is poisonous. It will kill you if you eat it. It will also bite your finger off because it has fused teeth that make it capable of biting through any net. It is in the EU forbidden to land it. So in southern Turkey, this fish has contributed about 50% of the catch, but it's not recorded because it is immediately thrown away. It caused the net to last about five times less than before. So if a fisher bought a net for $1,000, it has to be renewed five times faster than before because they eat up through the net. I have a former student, Aileen Ullman, who is Canadian-Turkish, who sits in Turkey, and we have written a number of papers about this fish because she has connected with a Chinese-Canadian firm that extracts poison out of them, extract drugs out of them that will be fight for cancer, the pain extreme to fight extreme pain due to cancer. And she also produced wallets and little objects out of the leather. She's learning to tan, to tanning of this skin. But the point is that most invasive species are in the north, in the Mediterranean are really nefarious. And what happens in the southern Mediterranean, in the east, especially in the Levantine Sea, is not that you have one invasive species or the other. It is that the Red Sea is emptying itself into the Med. Basically, the Red Sea is communicated with the Med so strongly that it becomes more and more like the Red Sea, the Mediterranean, the Eastern Mediterranean. And then once they are established in the Eastern Mediterranean, they go to other parts of the Mediterranean. And for example, this species has been reported from every country in the Mediterranean except France. I don't know why. It is a question of time until it shows up. And because the fishers don't know them, they are not reported in catch statistics. So you wouldn't know about it, about this invasion from the fishery. You would have to consult with biologists, marine biologists that write books about that. And this invasion is not only due to the fact that there is the Suez Canal and that it has been widened and that the Bitter Lake is not bitter anymore, is not it is not before the Bitter Lake was so, the salinity was so high that it was a barrier. And in the meantime, the salinity is the same, so that the fish that are in the Red Sea can comfortably enter the Mediterranean. And the result of all this is that the Red Sea, the Mediterranean is doomed to be invaded by species from the Red Sea, and in some places you can develop fisheries on them, on this new inhabitants. But the classical species of the Mediterranean, including hake, are things that will disappear. And so if I as a summary. Is that the Mediterranean has been fished for millennia and it's now overfished. That is, none of the program that are conducted in the north of the Red Sea, of the Mediterranean, are conducive to rebuilding the stocks. No, we know that rebuilding stocks is the way to go, but for that you have to fish less for a while. And no European country has done that and will do that. And this is, instead, what you have is when you have a situation where there is overfishing and you don't catch anything anymore, they then give you subsidies to continue fishing. And so the fisheries have completely stopped, ceased to be self-regulated. It's even worse in the southern Mediterranean because many countries feel that they have no choice but to encourage fishing, even if they have to subsidize the fishery, because of social problem and because this is also a food security issue, but basically, the margin of choice that that the countries in the South have are such that they never choose to rebuild the stocks. So the fishery science is quite clear. What we know what to do. It's like COVID and vaccination. We know what to do. Vaccine exists, but then some people don't want to be vaccinated, and then you're stuck. And basically, invasive species from the Red Sea will be gradually replaced native fish in the Mediterranean, and that is a nightmare scenario that would have happened anyway in terms of the moment the Suez Canal was built, but for a long time this was one species at a time, and the species had to fight their way into the Mediterranean, but the Mediterranean is being emptied, has been emptied of predatory fish. There are no sharks, almost no sharks, and big fish are gone. So the snow fish are coming in and have no predators. Moreover, the Red Sea is hotter than the Med, and the Med getting warmer, and the Eastern Mediterranean is way warmer than has warmed much faster than the rest of the world. The Eastern Mediterranean is like the Red Sea, and is the place where these nasty species all establish themselves and then move on to come to the west, to the western part of the Mediterranean, and also they can use Greece and then Italy to do the same in the north. So basically, native fish in the Mediterranean are doomed to disappear. And the fisheries will have to adapt, but there is a lack of scientists in the countries. There is a lack of there is, even though there is work that is being done, and it's getting better to do it. But the problem is not really the lack of scientists, but the fact that fisheries are everywhere neglected activities. The fisheries department are mainly within the agriculture department, the Ministry of Agriculture, and in these ministries, fisheries doesn't do well because conceptually, it is not the same as agriculture. Agriculture, you have an input, you put an input, and given the strength of your input, fertilizer, plowing, seeding, and everything, you get a big harvest. That is the output. Fisheries, we have no input. The sea produce the stuff, and that we harvest. And the in the ministries, there is the idea that boats are the inputs, boats, the vessels, and so there is the notion that the more boats we put out there, the more fish we will get, and it is always wrong, and it is a thinking that is very difficult to eradicate, and it has not been able. It is in very widespread in the ministries in the southern Mediterranean as elsewhere. So this is not going to be solved. It is possible that in the next years or decades, as global warming intensifies, and it becomes more and more difficult to burn fuel, the fisheries will be limited by that. But I don't see any possibility of limiting fisheries any other way. It is in the Mediterranean, even in the north, a series of failure to act that is sad, and in the south, you have more of it. Now, this is not necessarily positive what I have to say, but that's the best I can see. Further information on the fisheries of the southern Mediterranean, or any other place for that matter, can be obtained from our website. Most of the figures you have, no, most of them, were drawn from our website. Or I can send you papers about each country of the world. you have just to write. So you can write me, and I will send individual papers. And this is it. And I thank you very much. And now I can answer your questions.
Ivar, we don't hear you.
Pardon?
Ivar should unmute himself.
Yeah, here it is. Thank you very much, Daniel. Really, I see once more how the fisheries reflect all the problems of the world, including the political ones. This is, you managed to show it to all of us. And so there are questions. Some of them you largely answered. So I see here the first question. Do you see any future to artisanal fishery in the Mediterranean? You see, considering climate change and impact.
Yeah. Actually, the only future of fisheries that I see is artisanal fisheries. I believe that industrial fisheries are the reason why fisheries collapse everywhere, because essentially, if you construct a monster vessels and you use it to exploit an ecosystem, it's like you have a tank, you use a tank to hunt rabbits. You use heavy technology, heavy industry to hunt animals. And what you do is you punch holes in an ecosystem, and the ecosystem cannot handle that. On the other hand, if you insert yourself in a system and take a little bit from everything, then that system can continue. And artisanal fisheries are the future of fisheries, if fisheries are a future. If fisheries are to continue, it will have to be artisanal fisheries. And in the Med, that is the best case. The best case can be made for artisanal fisheries. Yeah.
Yeah, and it will help to rebuild societies as well.
Yep.
I see another question. Are all the global fisheries under stress of some sort? Will people no longer be able to consume fish in significant quantity by the end of the century?
Oh, by the end of the century, if we have not licked the problem or solved the problem of global warming and our emission, the issue will not be eating fish, but eating grain. Because global warming threatens our food security, not only because the fish, it's too warm for the fish, it's also too warm for rice, for wheat, and I think and the weather pattern are changing. So we, at the end of the century, if we have not dealt with the problem of global warming, we will have food security problem, where fish is not gonna be the main issue. If the main issue is grain and basic calorie need. And we see that already now, where if the Ukraine stop exporting, there is lots of countries that are immediately starving, one of them being Egypt. And Egypt, which has over 100 million people, is anticipating to have 200 million people in 21st century. And it is completely, if I may say that, it's completely insane. The notion that you have 200 million Egyptians living along the Nile is absurd. But 200 million Egyptians will not be eating fish anyway. They will be eating grain. And this grain will have to be coming from somewhere. And that we don't talk about population problem, but I think that is a big issue also. So my answer is, we will be eating fish. If we eat anything in the 21st century, if there is anything to eat, fish will be there also.
Thank you.
If.
Yeah, excellent. I have several questions about aquaculture.
Okay.
What do you think about aquaculture?
So aquaculture is often viewed as a solution to the fish supply problem, but especially in Mediterranean, people forget that aquaculture fish have to be fed, and they are fed with other fish, and as a result, the aquaculture as performed in the Mediterranean, that is tuna and also bass and other carnivores fish, aquaculture is not a fish producer but a fish consumer. It is important that you realize, those of you who are interested in aquaculture, that aquaculture as conceived in the Mediterranean is not a fish producer but a fish consumer, because you need 3-4 tons of fresh fish to produce 1 ton of aquaculture fish, if aquaculture is fish. And most people have problem with this point. The fish aquaculture in the Med, for example, in Turkey, in Greece, in Spain, and stuff, is very profitable because the wild stock have disappeared, and you can sell this fish for a good price. But it consumes sardine. The sardine are consumed, anchovies are consumed, and they are imported for this from somewhere else. Another point is that fish meal or fish pellets, which have to be fed in aquaculture, are consumed in enormous amount by China. And China is consuming about 60% of the world's production in fish meal. And this fish meal is based largely on sardine and anchovies. And when you know that sardine and anchovies are excellent to eat for people. So aquaculture as conceived as practiced around the Mediterranean is not sustainable because it consumes fish. Now, aquaculture as a technology can actually produce a net seafood, but it must not be based on carnivorous fish. It must be based on bivalves, oysters, mussels, and so on, which don't need to be fed. And the bulk of aquaculture in China is actually based on animals that don't have to be fed. As soon as you think about animals that have been to be fed, carnivorous fish, you are turning aquaculture into a net consumer of fish and not a net producer of fish.
Very clear. And I have another question. Is fishing by other nations' vessels, an important phenomenon in the economic zones of Morocco, Tunis, Libya, and Egypt.
It is important in at least until a few years ago, but I think it's still the case. Tuna fishing in by France in and perhaps Spain also in the Libyan EEZ is a big thing. Tuna fishing. On the other hand, Morocco fish extensively in the western Mediterranean, and it fish more outside than others fish inside. It's the economic zone, and Egypt is also fishing a lot. Nobody that I know of is fishing in Egyptian water, but Egypt fishes in Libya, in other countries very strongly. So some countries in the southern Mediterranean are themselves fishing in other countries. And Egypt is one, and Turkey also is one that fish elsewhere, and Morocco is one also that themselves are fishing outside. From the north, there is Italian vessel fish in the open Red Sea, in the open Mediterranean, and France again in Libya very strongly.
Well, you got us very interested with this goat gangster fish coming from the Red Sea, of course. But is it what's the future of that? Because you said it had no predators, but if it had no predators in the Mediterranean, it has no predators in the Red Sea either. So there must be a stop.
Yes, this fish can be consumed by sharks. I don't know how they do that because these fish are highly poisonous, but they do have predators. And in the Pacific, you don't hear about explosion of lionfish or explosion of this fish that it actually is blowing itself. It's one of these balloon fish. They are no explosion of them. So they are consumed, they have predators, maybe not as adult, but maybe as juvenile. But lionfish, that's another fish that I could have mentioned. A lionfish and this horrible Sceleratus fish, they have no predators in the Med because the Med has lost all the big fish that they had. There is a beautiful film that was done in 1942, before Jacques Cousteau made his first movie in 44 or 43, an underwater movie that was done in Greece, in the Aegean Sea. And it shows the camera pans around and you can see only sharks. The Eastern Med was full of sharks. And now there is no, the sharks are perhaps 1% of what they were before. And so there is no top-down control. And so there is anything that gets in can proliferate.
But why are there no sharks in the Mediterranean? No one eats sharks.
They have been killed because they are competitors, that's one thing. Dynamite fishing and so on.
Yeah.
They are competitors because they eat other fish. They have been killed and since the 70s, 80s, because of their fin, which can be exported to China. And now increasingly, they are fished for their flesh. And this is a development that is recent. There are entire countries that have become massive importer of carcasses. And this is interesting because you can see the law of unintended consequences. The sharks were being wiped out by fishing for their fins that produce in China shark fin soup. And so legislation was passed in the European Union that you have to land the sharks with the fins attached. So that the idea was that it will occupy so much space in the hull of the fish, the shark carcasses, that they will lose money at shark fishing. This has not happened. They have instead found a market for shark meat. And so they are now anti-country that rely on shark meat. One of them is Brazil, that imports lots of shark meat. Also, many African countries now eat shark meat commonly, which is very bad for you because sharks bioaccumulate all kind of nasty stuff, mercury, among other things. But sharks have been, that's the reason why they are devastated everywhere they are. And in the Mediterranean, basically all species of sharks have suffered. And in fact, this is, people don't know that, but 100 years ago, you had white sharks off the coast of Croatia that ate people, and they're gone now.
I have a question here. I'm not sure I understand it fully, but it seems interesting. Now, do you think that as a paradigm, food sovereignty would produce a better policy framework than food security? You see, it is better to think of food.
If you were thinking about food sovereignty, I guess being capable of producing your own food in your own country, you would have to address issues of demography, because countries like Egypt, to take that example, don't have the land to produce enough. So the idea of food sovereignty is inapplicable to many, many of the countries. And it's also the case for Libya. It's also the case. Let's not forget that in Syria, what triggered the civil war was the failed integration of 3 million farmers that had been driven from the land into the cities. And I don't see that country regaining food, regaining a situation where they can produce enough food. So basically, the idea of food sovereignty immediately posed demographic question. And I think that would then allow to address the real issue, that one real issue that we have, which is population growth. That is everywhere a taboo subject, but we'll have to address it, because if millions of people, at a billion now, that are coming on, that are added to the world population, are to have a decent level of material life, that cannot be done with the present arrangements. And I don't know how the food can be produced.
Well, we're nearing the close, so perhaps I'll give you the two last questions that we stop. One is, does the North Mediterranean do any better than the South Mediterranion? That's the first question.
Not true. And that is the astonishing thing. The European Union has huge amount of money, spends huge amount of money on fisheries and research project and stuff in the north. But the fisheries are not really better run in the north than in the south. The fishery scientists in the north should work with those in the south much more, because they share a misery of not being listened to.
Yeah, that's the same people that work in climate change and so on.
Yeah.
And, well, it's really a broad question, but we can all have our own answer. But what would the, can we imagine the impact of disappearing fish stock on communities in the south of the Mediterranean?
We can imagine it because this is already happening in some countries in West Africa. And one of the impact in Senegal, for example, one of the impact is that the young men are forced to leave, and they leave and they try to go to Europe. And that is the catastrophe that failed development causes. The young men have no alternative. They cannot continue to fish because there'd be big Russian and big Chinese and Spanish trawlers have exterminated the population of fish, because the fish that are there, the few that are there, are exploited by bigger boat. So these young men have to leave. They have to leave. If they have a family, they have to leave and hope to get a job picking fruit or collecting olive in Spain. And they try to get into the European Union. And I think this is the catastrophe a model that will happen in other countries. I mentioned when we were talking about Algeria, I mentioned a big project that subsidizes the acquisition of small boats for young people. But it is like in France about 200 years, 150 years ago, when under the Second Empire, people were supposed to dig holes, and then they fill the holes and they dig up again. If you cannot employ people in something that is really productive, you will go broke, or you will get trouble later. And so the fact that the government continue to help and to support industrial fishing, where artisanal fishing would employ far more people, if, for example, is a misdevelopment. But how can you prevent it from happening, given that the trawl operators have political power and the small-scale fishers don't? That is the politics on the ground make this impossible.
Thank you very much, Daniel. Well, I'm talking to the audience. I think you can see why Daniel Pauly has such an influence on me and on us scientists. I may say, Daniel, that, and talk also to mathematicians, that at Dauphine we're starting a program on mathematics and fisheries in the hope of getting more scientists interested in these problems, because which cover everything. You see, you cover the economics, you cover the politics, and so on. It's really science for development, for biology, and so on. It's important, I think, also that not only we know about that, but that our students are taught about this. I think this is crucial for the future. So thank you very much, Daniel.
You're welcome. And I think you can contact me to get information on any country more deeply, deeper information. And the website has my address. The PowerPoint has my address. Thank you.
And thank you. And I will announce the next conference, which is a conference by Mark Smith on January 11th. And the talk is Ibn al-Haytham, Analysis of the Moon Illusion. It's a case, it's a specialist of the history of science, a case study on an example of scientific progress. So this concludes the session. Thank you very much, all of you, and special thanks to Daniel Pauly. Bye now.
Thank you. Yeah, bye.